Stand before your throne, dressed in glory not my own. What a joy I'll sing of on that day. No more tears or broken dreams, forgotten is the minor key. Everything as it was meant to be. And we will worship. Presence, we will sing. We will worship.
Morning, folks. Morning, morning. Good to hear the chatter and everything as people are coming in. We're going to play a song which we regularly do, just to get our thoughts, our hearts, our minds into a place where we're coming to worship God this morning. This is a lovely song. It's not one we know particularly well. It's called One My Heart, and it's sung to us by the group from St. Ebb's Church in Oxford. So just enjoy this and listen to the words.
Thank you.
Good morning again, and welcome. And welcome if you're tuned in online as well. My name's Steve Burmester, I'm the vicar here. Our curate's on holiday at the moment, so they'll be having a great time. It's the summer months, so people are away, enjoying a bit of a rest, but welcome to you. At the end of summer, we want to get our children's work started again in September, and we are going to do that. And if you'd like to help, we really do need as many people to help as possible. Just have a word with me. That would be great. We also want to get our music group back. We haven't got Gareth this morning. He's on holiday. So we're going to start our music group again in September, but we need musicians. So if you can play, please have a word with myself or Gareth after the services. Well, we're working our way through a little part of the letter to the Ephesians, and we're going to carry on with that this morning. But before we do that, let's tell ourselves words of truth as we begin. A prayer. Let's say this prayer together. It describes how Jesus describes himself. So let's say this as we begin. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the bread of life. Let us feast on you and find nourishment for our souls. You are the light of the world. Let us follow you out of the darkness. You are the door. Let us enter the Father's presence in your name. You are the good shepherd. Let us rest in your provision. You are the resurrection and the life. Let us find true life and victory in you. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Let us love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We pray this in your name. Amen. Wonderful description of all the ways that Jesus describes himself. The way, the truth, and the life is what we're going to be thinking about this morning. We're going to sing a great hymn. Rejoice, the Lord is King. Let's stand and sing this together.
Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adored. Mortals give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, Jesus, the Savior reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat. Up to their eternal home, we soon shall hear the angel's voice, the trump of God shall sound. Lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice.
Please do be seated. Fantastic words, aren't they? Some more words of truth we're going to say to one another now. If you say the words in green, God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. And some verses from Scripture. New verses for August. From Ephesians 5. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. From Psalm 84. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. And from 1 Peter. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Great words of truth, which we're going to hear a bit more about this morning. But let's pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I said a moment ago that we're going to be thinking through a little part of the book of Ephesians. We've been studying it together now for quite a few weeks. And we're just going to look at one or two verses this morning. This is a children's talk. We haven't got children with us, but they're watching online, some of them. And anyway, adults always get something out of the children's talk as well. So I'm going to put a picture up in a moment of a very famous character. And it might give you a bit of a clue as to what we might be thinking about this morning. Let's have the picture up. So, most people will know who this guy is. Good old Pinocchio. And we're going to watch a little clip in a moment of probably the most famous aspect of Pinocchio, that when he doesn't tell the truth, what happens? So here you go.
Pinocchio, why didn't you go to school?
School? Well, I...
Go ahead, tell her.
I was going to school till I met somebody.
Met somebody?
Yeah, two big monsters with big green eyes. Why, I...
Monsters? Weren't you afraid?
No, ma'am, but they tied me in a big sack.
You don't say. And where was Sir Jiminy?
Oh, Jiminy?
Leave me out of this.
They put him in a little sack.
No.
Yes.
How did you escape?
I didn't. They chopped me into firewood. Oh, look. My nose. What's happened?
Perhaps you haven't been telling the truth, Pinocchio.
Perhaps.
Oh, but I have. Every single word. Oh, please help me. I'm awful sorry.
You see, Pinocchio, a lie keeps growing and growing until it's as plain as the nose on your face.
She's right, Pinocchio. You better come clean.
I'll never lie again. Honest, I won't.
Please, Your Honor. Miss Fairy, give him another chance. For my sake, will you?
I'll forgive you this once. But remember, a boy who won't be good might just as well be made of wood.
How long ago is it since you've seen that? Quite a while, I imagine. They're remaking it on Netflix. It's coming out at Christmas. I think it'll be a little bit different to the Walt Disney version. But the Walt Disney version was a little bit different to the original story. I don't know if you even know what the original story was. Disney produced this in 1940. We'll let the guys come on in. Come on in, guys. Disney produced it in 1940. The original story was written in 1880. And it was set in Tuscany, in Italy. And it wasn't as nice as Disney's version of it. It might not surprise you to hear that. For example, Jiminy Cricket appears when Pinocchio's run away from his master, and he gets his master into big trouble because he lies about him. He says to the authorities that Geppetto had abused him, and so they arrest him and throw him in prison, Geppetto. And when Jiminy Cricket comes to Pinocchio and says, "You really shouldn't have done that, that was wrong," Pinocchio throws a hammer at him and kills him. So you see, the original story is a little bit darker. And when the nose grows, it only grows once in the original story. It grows so long that the fairy calls woodpeckers to come and chop it down to size afterwards. You should look up the original story. It's a bit darker, it's a bit more gruesome. Pinocchio ends up getting hanged from a tree, and that was supposed to be the end of the story. It was supposed to tell children, don't tell lies because you'll get into big, serious trouble. But they made him write a happy ending to the story. So, what are we thinking about this morning? Telling the truth. And that's what our passage will look at in just a moment. But let's read it. It's from Ephesians 4. If you want to follow it along in the blue Bibles, you'll find it on page 1176. And it's what we looked at last week, but we've got one of the verses that we're going to examine this morning. So, Ephesians 4, beginning at verse 17. Paul says, "So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body." This is God's word. Before we unpack that, we're going to sing again. This is a beautiful hymn. We've listened to it quite a lot, and you might be familiar with it, might be new to you, but let's stand and sing it, and as you get to know it, Ancient of Days. It's a beautiful song. Let's stand and sing.
Kingdoms rise and fall.
do. Be seated. So if you want to follow along with that passage that we just read, it is on page 1175 and 1176 of the Church Bibles. And we began this passage last week, didn't we, if you were with us? We looked at the fact that Paul insists that we change, that we change our behaviour, that as Christians we can't behave like the people in the world around us, how they often behave, because God's nature and God's character is different. We saw that when we became a Christian, then we were like born again, that we were made new and that we needed to grow. Christ comes into our lives through the Holy Spirit. And because Christ is in us and he's paid the price for all our sin, he makes us right in God's sight. So that now when God looks at us, he views us as holy, as perfect in every way. And we saw that Paul insists that we bring our behaviour now in line with who we are in God's sight. And that affects every single area of life, every aspect of our lifestyle and our attitudes. And we saw that Paul showed us how that change should take place, that it involves our minds being renewed, made new by God, a new way of thinking. But that we're to work it out as well in our lives. We're to put off the old life and put on the new life. And that's what we're thinking about. I want to pray, just as we begin our sermon, that we'd have hearts that are open to hear what God's word is saying. So let's just bow our heads to pray. Father, we want to be made new in the attitude of our minds, in the way we think. We want to live in step with your Spirit and be like you in character. We want the fruit of the Spirit to come out of our lives, the love, the joy, the peace, the patience, the kindness, the goodness. So, Lord, as we study your word now, help us to have open ears to hear what your Spirit is saying and open hearts to receive it for your glory. Amen. So originally I was going to look at the whole of this passage in one go and then move on to chapter 5. But as I studied it, I just realised there's so much in it, so much to talk about, so much to think through, that we're actually just going to take one verse a week and dig into it. And we're not going to get beyond chapter 4 by the end of summer. But we're going to sort of really examine it in detail. So over August, we're going to take each area of our lives that Paul talks about in these few verses. We're going to dig down into it. Today, we're going to look at truth-telling, being truthful to one another. Next week, and it'll be interesting to see who doesn't come, we're going to be talking about anger and anger management. The week after that, we're going to be talking about theft and stealing. And the final week of August, we're going to be looking at our speech in general, about forgiveness, about bitterness, about critical attitudes. And so it's really practical and it's very, very applicable to our lives. It's not an exhaustive list, but it gives us examples which will help us in other areas of our lives. So today we are looking at putting off falsehood, lies, deceit, exaggeration, and putting on truthfulness, integrity, and honesty. Joe and I have been watching an old TV drama series. It's on iPlayer. It was back about 20 years ago it came out. It was called Hustle. I don't know if anyone watched it. It's quite funny. It's about a bunch of con artists in London. And they're like modern day Robin Hoods. So they only con bad people, immoral people, greedy people, and they get lots of money off them and give them to the people who they've conned. And it's a well-written, well-acted, it's very clever storylines. And in an episode we were watching the other day, one of the con artists falls and he bangs his head and he knocks himself unconscious. And then when he came to, he found out he couldn't tell any lies. He could only tell the truth, which is a bit of a problem for a con artist. And it's quite funny. And Eventually, he falls over and bangs his head again later on, and he can tell lies again. But it's a problem for a con artist when you can't tell a lie, and that's what the story is. And you laugh at it and everything like that, and it's cleverly written. But con artists are not like that, are they? They don't just con greedy, immoral people. They con ordinary people, like you and me. We've been the victim of quite serious cons and scams, and you may well have been too, and it's a horrible thing. Lies and deceit destroy people. Unfortunately, they're commonplace in our culture, aren't they? Right from the very top down to the very bottom. We are immersed in lies and deceit through media, through just speaking to people around us. And we learn to lie from a very young age, don't we? We've got neighbours on both sides with young children. And during the summer in particular, you can hear them playing out, and it's great fun. And they're primary age children. But it's very interesting overhearing some of the conversations that go on. Something like this happened the other day. So, Charlie, did you hit your sister? No. Why is she crying and said you hit her? I don't know. You know that sort of line, don't you? Little children, they learn to lie, to cover up the truth at a very young age. It's quite scary when you think about it, how young children are when they start to tell lies. And they tell them for obvious reasons. They tell them to keep themselves out of trouble. We tell them to make ourselves look better in people's eyes. We exaggerate things so they're a little bit better than they might actually be. We lie to get something we want. And there are lots and lots of other reasons why we lie. So the motives that lead us to tell lies, they're deeply ingrained in us from a very young age. They're about self-image, self-preservation, self-worth. And what Paul says is all of those things change fundamentally when you become a Christian. Our sense of worth shouldn't be what other people think of us, because we know that God views us as beautiful in his sight. Our sense of worth should come from that. And so Paul says that we should change utterly deep down in our attitude towards telling the truth. It's so interesting that the very first practical application of putting off the old and putting on the new is about telling the truth, isn't it? Have you ever wondered why he picks that one as the first example? Jesus describes himself as the truth, the way, the truth, and the life. If you want to look at what a life lived out in complete truth looks like, look at Jesus. Look at how he thinks. Look at how he speaks. Look at what he does. It's truth lived out. So we're going to apply Paul's teaching here to our lives. What we put off and what we put on. But just a couple of thoughts before we dig into this. It's important to say these things. Firstly, Christianity is for failures. I just want to say that. Because when we look at moral things like this, we might think it's about being good, being a good person. And as Christians, we are to be good, and we are. But we don't become Christians by being good. We're accepted by God because we're failures. In fact, until we realize we're failures, we can't find God. It's only people who realize their need of God who can come into his kingdom. In fact, if you think about it, the people farthest from the kingdom that Jesus met were the moral people, a lot of the upright people who thought that they were good enough. They were far from the kingdom of God, whereas it was the people who were the tax collectors and sinners, as he describes them, that were drawn to Jesus. They knew they were failures. They knew they needed God's mercy and forgiveness. So we have to see our need of God's forgiveness before we can come to him. But secondly, and perhaps even more importantly, at the heart of this list, we didn't read it all this morning, but at the heart of this list, in verse 30, you read this. Paul says, "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. It's strange in some ways that Paul should put that comment in the middle of really practical things. Don't lie, don't steal, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Get rid of all bitterness. Right in the middle, he's talking about grieving God. Why does he put that there? It's important to understand that the way we behave affects God's emotions. Now, that's a strange thing to say, but that's what Paul is saying. Grief is a powerful emotion, isn't it? If you've ever grieved for someone, you know how deep that pain goes. And Paul says that when we lie, when we are selfish, when we steal, we grieve God. That God has somehow bound up his emotions with us. When we sin, we hurt him. He's shattered emotionally. We tend to think that God is impervious to anything. He's almighty. Oh, he is almighty. But we can hurt him by the way that we live. So why don't we lie? Because it hurts God. So those two kind of foundations to what we're about to look at are important. So what do we actually do to put off this area of life? Paul uses an interesting word. He doesn't say put off lying, does he? He doesn't say that. What does he say? He says put off falsehood. Why doesn't he say don't lie, just tell the truth? And this is really important because it exposes a blind spot in our thinking. It's possible, and you know this, not to tell a lie technically, but not to tell the truth either. The reason why Paul doesn't say don't lie, tell the truth, is because it's a bigger thing than just lies. So, example, here's Andrew, here's Barry, here's Callum. They are witnesses to an event. Dave is accused of robbing a bank. Andrew, Barry, and Callum all know with certainty he did not rob a bank. But Andrew says, I saw Dave rob a bank. That's a lie. Barry says, I saw Dave near the bank that night. Callum comes along and says, nothing at all, even though he knows that Dave is innocent. All three of them are not being truthful, but only one of them is technically telling a lie. Do you see why Paul uses the word get rid of falsehood? Because it's much bigger, it's much broader than just telling a lie. They're all deceiving. They're all expressions of falsehood. And it goes right back to the beginning of the Bible. This is where the roots of our lies come from. What's the very first thing that you read about in the Bible? About Adam and Eve in the garden. God gives them one command, doesn't he? You can't have that fruit. You can have anything else, just not the fruit from that one tree. So what happens is the serpent comes along, the father of lies, comes along and he deceives. And deceived Eve, and Adam stood next to her, so he can't get out of it either. And they eat the fruit. And what's the first thing that happens after they eat the fruit? If you know the story, what do? They hide. They hide behind a bush, which is a bit daft, really, if you think about it, because does God not know they're hiding behind a bush? But anyway, they hide behind a bush, they put clothes on, they hide from each other, and they even hide from themselves. At the end of Genesis 2, we read something beautiful. We read that Adam and Eve were naked and they were unashamed. They were completely open, completely vulnerable, and there was no shame at all in their lives. The minute that sin comes in, the minute that they break God's rule, they hide, they're ashamed, they're fearful, and they cover themselves up. And God comes to Adam and says, did you eat of the fruit I told you not to eat from? Now, what does Adam say? Does he say, yeah, I'm sorry? Nope. Do you remember what he says? It's her. She made me do it. Not telling the truth, blame shifting. What does Eve do? It's the serpent. He made me do it. And the old joke goes, the serpent didn't have a leg to stand on. But isn't it interesting that the very first thing that happens after they break God's commands is they hide and they lie. And it's been in our nature and in our character ever since. We even deceive ourselves. It wasn't really my fault. It was her fault. It was his fault. And it's deceiving ourselves. I remember reading years ago when cigarette packets first got health warnings on them, and it says cancer, cigarettes can kill you, and things like that. I remember reading in a newspaper that there were protests that these things were on the cigarette packets, protests outside the cigarette factory. And I remember reading one interview with a guy who said, "We want the non-cancer packs back. We want the packs that tell us that we're not going to die." As if that makes a difference. But we deceive ourselves. We think, well, if the pack doesn't say we'll die of cancer, we won't. Satan is the ultimate deceiver, isn't he? He's even described as the father of lies. And in the Garden of Eden, in that conversation with Eve, you see that he distorts the truth. He tells a little bit of it, but then he twists it and changes it. And when you read that conversation carefully, Satan is the master of telling lies. And in some ways, when we do the same, we put ourselves under his dominion. Think about that. We behave like Satan does. When we lie, when we tell untruths, distortions, then we're in Satan's domain. And Paul says, you were darkness, but now you're light. So live in the light. Live in the way that God is. God is not a God of untruth. He's a God of truth. When we live and we lie, we stay enslaved to sinful life. The great preacher Martin Lloyd-Jones illustrates this really well. He said that during the American Civil War, the laws about slavery were changed, and slave owners had to free their slaves. And he goes on to say that they were granted legal freedom. There wasn't anything in law that meant that they had to stay enslaved to their masters. But what happened was that even though they'd been freed, many of them didn't want to leave their cruel masters behind. They stayed enslaved to them. They were free, but they stayed. And Lloyd-Jones says that's true of us as Christians. When we break God's law, when we lie, we are free. We've been set free by Jesus and what he did for us. But when we continue in that old way of life, we remain chained, enslaved to the father of lies. So Paul says, put off all falsehood and put on truth. So let's think about that. How do we put on truth? Two thoughts to finish with. Paul says in verse 23, be renewed in the attitude of your minds. Putting on truth means soaking ourselves in truth. You see, we absorb what's in the media, and a lot of it is falsehood. So Paul says, soak yourself in the truth. Study God's word. Study it yourself in the morning. Study it together. We've got house groups going again. Some of them are already going. Some of them are going to start in September. And new ones are going to start. Study God's word together. Listen to sermons. Listen to teaching. Read books. Soak yourself in the truth. We have to do that because every day when we watch things on TV, when we go out into our culture, so much of what we absorb is not truth. I remember that came home to me when I read about an advert, and this is going back quite a long time. It was an advert for Nescafe coffee. And you might remember the advert. It's a girl who's upset. She's driving a VW Beetle, one of the old ones, and she drives up to the top of a cliff early in the morning, just as the sun is coming up. Do you remember this? And she gets out. She's tears falling down her face. She's obviously upset about something. And she gets a jar of Nescafe out, and she finds one of those little plug-in water cup boilers. Do you remember those? Where you could plug it into the cigarette lighter and put it in the cup and make yourself hot water. And she makes herself a little cup of coffee, and she gets out of the VW Beetle. She puts the coffee on the top of the Beetle, and the sun starts to rise, and the music comes on in the background. I can see clearly now the way. Do you remember that? Vaguely. It's a brilliant advert, absolutely brilliant. But what struck me about it was that apparently the sale of VW Beetles went through the roof. So did those little coffee cup heaters. And that song went to the top of the charts. I don't know what it did for Nescafe sales, but everything else. Do you see, you absorb things. I mean, now it's part of marketing. It's called product placement. They realized then that just by having something there, we're influenced by it. And we're influenced constantly by untruths in our society. So Paul says, you've got to counteract that by soaking yourself in the truth. Secondly, we need to speak truthfully to one another. And there's a reason for that Paul gives us, because we're all members of the same body. We need to build each other up and strengthen each other. And we do that by telling each other the truth. So we need to be careful in our answers. And we need to distinguish between truth and our own opinion. Sometimes when we think we're telling someone the truth, we're actually just telling them our opinion of things. But truth telling is really, really important. You see, we've already said you can not tell a lie, but it's not the truth either. We can deceive others. We might call them white lies, or being kind rather than telling the truth. Often we tell ourselves that it's because we're scared of upsetting someone that we won't tell them the truth. So we fudge it, we deceive, we avoid saying it as it really is. Just imagine that Jesus Christ had behaved like that. Rather than telling us the truth, not wanting to upset us, he didn't tell us completely the truth. Now, we need to check our motives when we tell the truth. We need to check we're not secretly wanting to have a go at that person, that actually we're telling the truth for the right reasons. Think about the conversation that Jesus has with the rich young ruler who comes to him and asks him, what do I have to do to get eternal life? It says, just before Jesus said, go and sell everything and come and follow me, it says that Jesus looked at him and loved him. He was about to tell him a hard truth, but he told him it because he loved him. And that has to be our motive as well. We need to think about times when we might be tempted to exaggerate. Someone described exaggeration as word inflation. I like that. Inflation's damaging to culture, isn't it? But word inflation, exaggeration, is just as damaging. I think this is one of the temptations that we all face. But perhaps as a minister, I face this one quite a lot. You see, when I'm with colleagues, other ministers, they're often asked the question, so how's church? How's it going? How many people are coming to your church? And it's so tempting just to nudge the figures up a bit, because you want to look good. Oh, we've got about 100 people coming. She's about 65. You know. It's so tempting, isn't it? It's so easy just to inflate a little bit, to make things sound better than they are. But that's not the truth. So we have to check ourselves. We don't have to be dishonest to defend ourselves. We know that Christ defends us. We don't have to lie to make ourselves look better. God's told us just how valuable we are and how worth we are to him. Adam and Eve hid from God. I've already said it's a bit illogical to do that. God sees everything. So we can't hide from God. God has made us acceptable in his sight. Think about how that happened. You see, Jesus, when he died on the cross, he was stripped naked. He didn't hide from God. He had nothing to hide, but he took our sin on himself. He took our shame on himself, it says. He took the punishment, the blame that we deserved. He became vulnerable so that we can be honest. We can be vulnerable with each other. He is the way, the truth, and the life. So we need to put off falsehood and put on truth-telling. Let's pray together, shall we? Let's pray. Lord, this is an area of life that we all face the temptation to fall at. Forgive us for times when we have done that. In our speech, in our thinking, when we've hidden the truth, when we've hidden from you. Help us, Lord, to check our motives, to check our speech with one another, to be truth tellers, to love one another, and to build each other up in how we speak. For your glory. Amen. Now, each week, we're doing these very practical things. We're going to put the confession after the talk, because it may well be that as we come now to say a confession together, that you need to just come in your hearts before God and say, Lord, you know I didn't tell the truth then. You know that I need your forgiveness. So let's just take a moment's quiet. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So let's turn away from sin and darkness and turn to Christ, the light of the world. So a moment's quiet. Come in your own hearts before God. So confessing our sins in penitence and faith, we say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Bible tells us that when we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us. So may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to stay in an attitude of prayer, and Greg is going to come and lead us in our intercessions.
Let us pray. Blessed be your glorious name. Heavenly Father, we lift our prayers to you for your church, for the world, for our community, for each other and for ourselves. We glorify you, Heavenly Father, and we thank you for the answers to our prayers and for all that you provide. May we serve you, Lord, by our thoughts, words, and actions. As you forgive us our sins, we pray that we are forgiving of others who we feel have wronged us. We pray that by the Holy Spirit's power, we are protected from temptation and evil. As Paul wrote to the Ephesians, so we seek to be imitators of you, Heavenly Father, as dear children, and not to partake in sinful ways. We pray by the Holy Spirit for an understanding of the Lord's will for us. And as Paul writes, we walk not as fools, but as wise. We pray that our actions reflect our faith in you, Heavenly Father. Paul said, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Father, we pray that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, we pray for our country and for those in positions of leadership. We thank you for the many sporting events that are taking place, bringing together teams and individuals from many nations, their supporters and wider audiences. We thank you, Lord, as we remember the 50th anniversary of the Ugandan Asian situation and at the death of the activist Roy Hackett last week. We thank you for how far our country has progressed in race relations and acceptance of minorities. We remember in our prayers those for whom life is more difficult than for others, especially at a time of rising inflation, be they in our immediate community or elsewhere. We pray that we take the opportunity to give generous support in their time of need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, we pray for the world and especially for peace in Ukraine and for the safety and well-being of all involved. We pray for your solution to the resulting fuel issues and food shortage. We lift to you the tension between China and the USA. Wherever there is conflict in the world, we ask that your wisdom falls on those in political, economic, and strategic power, that they show discernment and compassion. We pray for safety and protection for all those experiencing persecution and discrimination, whether for their belief, their faith, or for who they are. We pray for love and tolerance between all people. We lift before you, Lord, the pandemic, and thank you for the great progress that's been made. Whilst infection persists, we pray for your protection and give thanks to all who've played their part selflessly throughout these last 2.5 years. As we bring to mind the many difficulties in the world, we also celebrate and thank you, Lord, for the beauty of your handiwork. There are many issues, including climate change and care for the environment, and so, Lord, we pray that we are worthy stewards of your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this community and pray for all those who live and work here. We lift to you your church everywhere in the world and pray for your blessings on the church family here at St. Chad's, especially for the children and young people, that they will know that you are beside them at all times. And may they and the staff in our schools and colleges enjoy their summer holiday in safety. We pray for the Christians in Schools Trust and lift to you the team as they make preparations to go about their work in local schools in September. We lift to you our vicar, Steve, and curate, Richard, the readers, church wardens, and other additional teachers, PCC members, and all who take a lead with the many initiatives here at church. Father, be with them all and with their families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, we lift to you in prayer all known to us with particular needs, and also those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Some are named on the church update notices. Others will be known personally to us. All are known to you, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we'll say the words of the collect together. Lord God, your Son left the riches of heaven and became poor for our sake. When we prosper, save us from pride. When we are needy, save us from despair, that we may trust in you alone, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Greg, thank you very much indeed. We're going to close our service by singing a great hymn. It's one we've sung a couple of times before. It's called the Hymn of the Saviour. It's great words. If you don't know it, then just join in as you get to hear it. Let's stand and let's sing together. Seated for a final prayer together. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Let's say this prayer together. God of power, may the boldness of your Spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your Spirit lead us. May the gifts of your Spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. But but join us for coffee and refreshments next door. God bless you.